Hello, good evening, everyone. My name is Kevin McCoy. I'm an associate professor of art at New York University, and I'm here this year with all my wonderful colleagues getting NYUAD off the ground. But tonight, I wanted to say a few words as a way of introduce our speaker tonight, Marina Zurkow. Marina is an artist who lives in New York, who has a very interesting and varied body of work. Her work is coming from a tradition and a context of media art and filmmaking, but has long since expanded itself and engaged with a wide variety of digital technologies and interactive technologies. Her work began in the very interesting late 90s New York net art period with a lot of really interesting projects that dealt with online narratives, interactive forms, social networking, early social networking efforts. But her latest work has branched off into considerations of how human characters are interacting and interfacing with the environment and with animals, more specifically. She's one of the few artists that has successfully navigated the difficult jump between media art and the gallery world. She shows with Bryce Workowitz Gallery in New York, which is an important gallery dealing with this kind of difficult area. And she is amongst some of the most important American media artists in that gallery. This summer and this fall, she's premiering a brand new work at another very interesting New York gallery, Marion Spohr, with the curator Michael Connor, who was just named one of the four most young curators to watch. And she's going to be presenting what seems to be a very beautiful project there. So she has, her work is in a number of collections, the Houston Fine Arts Museum, SF MoMA, San Francisco Museum of Modern Art, and the Smithsonian, amongst others. But I'm going to get out of the way so that we can see what Marina has to show for us tonight. So please join me in welcoming Marina Zurkow.
So thank you all so much for coming tonight. And thank you to Philip Kennedy and to the Institute for inviting me to speak. And of course, to my lovely and generous host, Una Chowdhury, for helping to engineer this. Thank you. So the title of this talk, in The Future Is Now, suggests an urgency. Sounding like a worn science fiction trope, the phrase's origins are long forgotten. Many people lay claim to it, but I'm fairly sure that this is the source.
Radiation, fission, fusion, pile, radioactivity, neutron, gamma rays, solar power, transistor, automation. A new language has come into currency. To the public, it is a language of the future. To the scientist, a language of the present. This, then, is a report on our present future, some of it profound, some of it mere gadgetry. In the final analysis, however, the key to the future is not an apparatus, a machine, or an electronic tube, but the brain power of man. Nothing will ever replace creative intelligence. In great laboratories, in colleges and universities, in solitary quiet, man thinks, reasons, experiments, creates. The mind strains to peer beyond today's horizons for a glimpse of the wonders of tomorrow.
So those were excerpts from a 1955 documentary promising video phones, smart kitchens, and solar energy. Future is now. And I could easily offer another well-worn cliche about time slips, which is that the past has an unpleasant way of hanging around. I'd like to start by framing some ideas before I talk about my own work. What did Disney's Magic Castle and the disaster movie 2012 have in common? Thomas Kincaid, the painter of light, and radical environmentalists. Timmy Treadwell, the real-world protagonist of Werner Herzog's Grizzly Man, and Jake, the marine-gone native in James Cameron's Avatar. Whether you're looking at enchantment, the apocalypse, documentaries, or fantasy fiction, all of these unlikely bedfellows are striving to describe human beings' relationships with nature. Be that magical, terrifying, dreaming of reunification, nostalgic, sorrow-filled, or vacuously optimistic. Now, I'd like to make a very general statement. The way that nature with a capital N is imagined in all of those representations is rooted both in Enlightenment values and in Romanticism's response to them. We still live with these 17th century values. The Cartesian separation of mind and body serves as a lens for capitalism with which to frame exploitative ventures. And in both reason and fantasy, the monolithic concept of man versus nature remains a useful one. Meanwhile, the poetic response to the Enlightenment, specifically Romanticism, gave us two legacies. One, a Hallmark Cards rendering of the natural world, and two, the birth of environmentalism. And both positions maintain that nature is over there while we are over here. Example A. This great failure of the imagination is slowly being amended, evinced by the popularization of news stories and nonfiction books on animal intelligence, by allocating funds towards scientific research such as Alex the Parrot and Bonnie Bassler's work in bacterial communication. And it's also being engaged in the recent work of thinkers like Jacques Derrida, Giorgio Agamben, and Donna Haraway. One of the artistic frameworks I find particularly useful to challenge the man versus nature binary is eco-poetics and eco-criticism, the fields of creation and study based in literature, criticism, and the environment. The works that are produced under this rubric actively and overtly account for the man-made and trace the historical and ideological roots of subjectivity. Many of the works shift our focus towards a redistribution of value, agency, and consciousness beyond the human. One key for the creators of ecopoetic works and theory is the engagement in interdisciplinary practices and research, including philosophy, animal studies, anthropology, and ecology. This back and forth between practices, each borrowing systems, information, ways of telling, and algorithms from the other, begins to create currents between artists' diverse methods of inquiry and expression, and connections across disciplines. Ecopoetics is far from didactic. Works of poetry and art are being made in order to suggest other points of view, ways of relating, and new methods of evaluating as new information rolls in. Poetics, normally reserved to discuss writing, is a system of making, a network of connected nodes performed through a set of principles. Ecopoetics has taken some of its ethos from algorithmic and procedural computation, from minimalist earth art, from ambient sound works, a heterogeneous mix. I'm interested in this talk to make connections between what I do as a media artist and an animator and these kinds of ideas. I'm of the mind that poetry and animations share a capacity to synthesize with an economy of means. They are tiny worlds set out on their own terms. They are markers of a kind of inquiry that has no a priori idiom or structure. So I started a series of animated works in 2006 that addressed flooding and climate change, weather and water as fact, and weather and water as metaphor. I made 11 works in all over a 3-year period. There are several features to these pieces. First, almost all of these works are rotoscoped, and rotoscoping is a technique of drawing directly over video footage. So they're handmade frame by frame drawings that are done, but you're basically tracing. Second, despite the fact that these works look like unified fields, each one is essentially a collage cobbled together from disconnected sources. Many of these works have a futuristic or fantastic tone to them, but all of the source footage for the rotoscoping was found on the internet. I'd call the internet an interdependent ecosystem in itself, a competing and complementary meme pool. All of the footage I use is real, in other words. It might resonate as something you saw somewhere before from news, from YouTube, or from stock footage websites. This, for example, is a first page of hundreds of pages of a search on amphibious housing. And I love the kind of accidents that happen when you do these searches, like this gentleman on the bottom on his amphibious bicycle. So a lot of these kind of accidents that happen in the process of searching wind up in the work. The third thing is that nearly all of the elements in these works are composed as loops. Because I work alone most of the time, and hand-drawn animation is so labor-intensive, using looped character behaviors is efficient. But these loops also have a distinct stuttering personality that adds to a sense of brokenness. And I think they poke a hole in the seamless rendered surfaces of the landscapes I portray. Lastly, I look at these works as ambient moving paintings, more than as narrative cartoons. They're reminiscent of Asian scroll paintings in both their formats and in the way that the landscape is moved across the screen. The works themselves are all loops, intended to be lived with ambiently rather than watched on a schedule the way you would a film. So I'm going to start with excerpts of a series of four animated videos called Elixir. These have been shown in this form as small wall-mounted videos. And they've also been shown as large-scale installations in traditional gallery settings. And as well, they've been shown in non-conventional venues like this villa doorway in Croatia, which faced a small ocean inlet and leisure boats would sort of pass by. That was the primary audience for this projection. They slept on the abyss without a surge. The waves were dead. The tides were in their grave. The moon, their mistress, had expired before. The winds were withered in the stagnant air, and the clouds perished. Written in 1816, Byron's Darkness is an apocalyptic poem that could have been lifted from biblical prophecy. But in fact, Darkness was based on the events of 1816 known as the Year Without a Summer. A dark, foggy haze hung over northern Europe and also over the northeastern United States. Crops were destroyed, and abnormally cold temperatures accompanied the sunlessness. Famine struck. Food riots broke out. Italy and Hungary experienced red and brown snow throughout the year. It happened that Mount Tambora had erupted in the Dutch East Indies in 1815, the most powerful volcanic eruption on record. No one at that time knew that this was the cause of global cooling, the cause of the year without a summer. And at the time, it appeared the world was ending. The poem Darkness has often been read as a last man poem, a popular literary subject of the time, the last man on earth. But Byron wrote the poem in response to the weather. In letters, he refers to, quote, the stress of weather that summer, end quote. So it's a poem in direct response to the weather. To an external climatic force interwoven in it are the cultural outcomes of environmental stressors, famine, starvation, wars, and riots that erupted out of resource scarcity. In his book, Song of the Earth, Jonathan Bates suggests that through the poem Darkness, Byron can be reclaimed as a prophet of ecocide. Bates writes, quote, "The weather is the primary sign of the inextricability of culture and nature. Peasants and sailors know the power of the weather in ways that scientists and politicians do not. Romanticism listens to the wisdom of sailors and peasants. It challenges the modern separation of culture from nature. Romanticism knows that, in Bruno Latour's phrase, a delicate shuttle has woven together the heavens, industry, texts, soul, and moral law." this next work is called The Poster Children. It was made in 2007 out of several events that had tipped in the media that year, and all of which depended on internet distribution in order to proliferate. While at the time of making The Poster Children, what interested me was creating a kind of theater of the Arctic. As I started to process what I'd made, what emerged was how territorial the world of images really is. That there's an everyday war being carried out over what you can call an ecosystem of images on the internet. I'd like to describe some of the pictorial tangles that I used to make this piece. Many of you may recognize this image and this one. The pair of polar bears standing on a sculptural chunk of free-floating ice was made famous in early 2007 when it graced the covers of major newspapers. The image was also used extensively by Gore, by Al Gore, included in his consciousness-raising presentations. The ice is melting. The polar bears are drowning. The photo quickly became a poster child for global warming. The backstory of this photo is that a grad student in marine biology named Amanda Bird took this photo in August 2004 while on a research boat in Alaska. A Canadian ice service worker took the picture from the shared computer on board the ship without Bird's knowledge and emailed it to Environment Canada, who in turn distributed the image to 7 media agencies. Soon after, the Toronto Telegraph, the New York Times, London's Daily Mail, and other papers worldwide ran the photograph as a primary illustration of global warming. In reality, the photo was taken from the boat when it was near shore at the warm end of summer, a time when the land's fringe ice naturally melts. Amanda Bird came forward publicly, angered that the photo was a misrepresentation, and she hadn't been credited. Her statement went to press. With this revelation, Rush Limbaugh and other right-wing pundits lambasted the image as propaganda promoted by, quote, environmentalist wackos in the media. 2007 was also the year that the polar bear rose again in popularity, when Knut was born at the Berlin Zoo. He came to public attention when his mother rejected him and he was adopted by his keeper. A lot of video about their relationship was passed around the internet. Knut's widespread fan club reinstated the polar bear as one of the world's most beloved, quote, charismatic megafauna, rivaling the panda bear. A second stream of imagery that fed into the poster children was e-waste, discarded electronics. 2007 marked the start of public awareness and pushback about the fact that we generate mountains of electronic waste, send it to Asia, Africa, or quietly use our own prison workforce to dismantle it, scavenging and salvaging components and metals. The salvaged metals are mostly removed without any protection against exposure and are fully toxic. A third stream of imagery you may recognize began with Sung-hee Cho, the Virginia Tech shooter. He was the first mass killer to distribute his own electronic press kit. You can see in the image he's a self-styled character straight out of John Woo's film Hard Boiled. NBC Television's willing distribution of the material was up on YouTube in less than 24 hours, spawning heated debates, race hate responses, and fake copycat threats in the form of YouTube videos. Cho is now tagged by some as, quote, the first Web 2.0 psycho killer, and the net result may be a possible template, even a challenge for aspiring mass murderers, end quote. This copycat killer in Finland uploaded a homemade video to YouTube entitled Jokkola High School Massacre, announcing the gunman's plans hours prior to the shooting. All the human models for the poster children came from YouTube. Most of the source videos were uploaded by teens who had access to guns or by proud parents teaching their kids how to shoot. The poster children were shown in several formats as a 4-channel mounted work and as a 2-channel projection. I assembled this bricolage of elements on an Arctic stage. The animation pours out in opposite directions from the center of the screens. The Arctic and Antarctica had by now become central characters in popular consciousness. They had historically been big, empty spaces for the imagination, but now, in the wake of Al Gore's movie, An Inconvenient Truth, images of icebergs melting were becoming a familiar and much contested landscape. His next work, Slurb, was a 2009 commission for a site-specific temporary public artwork in Tampa, Florida. It was to be part of an outdoor festival called Lights on Tampa. This is awesome Tampa you're looking at. Tampa and the entire Gulf of Mexico, the coast of the Gulf of Mexico, as you know, including New Orleans, is at risk for flooding. For the Gulf, it's primarily hurricane season. And the volume of these conditions is worsening from climate change. For Lights on Tampa, I wanted to make a piece that addressed this and to create a confluence of facts and speculations that were specific to the Gulf Coast and also global in scope. The Gulf used to have a healthy shrimp fishing industry, but pollutants, overfishing, and warming have worldwide altered the ocean's chemical balance, rendering it acid and deprived of oxygen. The result isn't only a significant decrease in diversity, but also a phenomenon referred to as the rise of slime. Slime being toxic algae and jellyfish, amongst other primordial forms that survive well in these new conditions. Trawling boats that used to be fitted for shrimp catches, like this one, have reconfigured their nets to catch jellyfish for the Asian market, where they're considered a delicacy. I wanted to transpose class and cultural concerns and ask questions about who and how might thrive in these new conditions. I started to do research to cast my characters, looking for ways to soften the blow. I wanted to make something that had the feeling of illustrations like the great 19th century satirist J.J. Granville, creating hybrid creatures and car-wrecked mermaids and a macabre Stephen King-like chorus that had traces of ethnographic portraiture and also mined a rich history of traditionally aquatic lifestyles that portrayed contemporary people accustomed to living on the water, like the members of the Intha tribe in Myanmar, whose waterways are now too polluted to remain sustainable. Similar communities like this exist throughout Asia, throughout East Asia. This is a farm contained on floating rafts on Inle Lake in Myanmar. And these could be an optimistic design expo on amphibious living. These are actually implemented Dutch, you know, Netherlands designed amphibious housing. I also was interested in creating a tailgate party from hell. This reality is becoming more widespread, as you can see in this picture from Northern England in 2008, the result of heavy rains flooding a small river. Finally, I wanted to make a travel narrative, one that unfolded like a Chinese scroll and that circled around continuously like a carousel, one that would take you from the city of Tampa and follow its landmarks out past the broken highways and into the suburbs and then back around again. And this is actually the storyboard for the 18-minute work. This is half the storyboard. This is the site that I projected Slurb within. Slurb was projected across the plaza from the building you see on the right, which is Tampa's ice hockey stadium. And fortuitously, the stadium was host to Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus during the week that Slurb was projected. So every evening at dusk, the elephants were walked across the plaza and into the building as the projection played. Of course, 2009 predated the recent British petroleum disaster in the Gulf of Mexico. When I made Slurb, there wasn't the same public upset around the state of the oceans. Now the piece is encoded with a very different resonance, as I recently experienced in Austin, Texas, when I showed the work in May.
Thank you.
This next piece moves away from some of the features that I described earlier on in the talk, although it shares, sadly, a lot of the thematic concerns. In 2008, I was commissioned by 01 San Jose, a new media festival in Northern California, to create a site-specific piece for the San Jose Convention Center. This is the Convention Center, which you can see has been temporarily bought out by eBay. The catch for the project was that the artwork would have to share screen time with local ads and closed-circuit broadcasts of events going on inside the convention center. The artwork would play every 10 minutes or so, acting as an interruption or break from the normal programming and the ads. I began to do some research on the history of Silicon Valley and on San Jose. You can get a sense of San Jose from this map, sort of, dominated by its highways that are highlighted in yellow. And you can see over here is the convention center, this big silver form, and the jumbo blue and white striped parking structure, which I'm pointing out because it sort of plays prominently in the piece. And over here, this green belt is a small river that snakes mostly under the highways. This is just one moment where it kind of peeks out, but it's mostly underneath this network of highways running north and south. Silicon Valley is a place I naturally thought of as having a really clean image. It produces technology, and technology is a clean industry, right? But the silicon and aeronautics industries based here have exposed and leaked more than 700 chemicals in the making of missiles, propellant fuel, and silicon chips. So in addition to workers' exposure, there's been significant groundwater contamination. Silicon Valley has the highest density of federally designated toxic Superfund sites anywhere in the United States. Superfund is the federal government's legislation where you become scheduled to get cleaned up if you have uncontrolled hazardous waste sites. And many Superfund sites are still waiting for cleanup, you know, two decades later. And then there are floods. This is a normal occurrence. The little river that I showed you on the map is regularly prone to flooding from heavy rains. This is a picture from 1911 taken in downtown San Jose, four blocks from the convention center. This is the little river, the Guadalupe River, that you can sort of see up close. It's a block from the convention center. The floods are more frequent now. The rains are less predictable, and they're heavier. So in 2001, and of course, the property and real estate values in downtown San Jose are worth a ton of money. So that's a big liability when it floods. So in 2001, the Army Corps of Engineers implemented the flood protection measures, which you can see in the form of this riverside park. Formally, the highways, the convention center, and the river share many features of poured concrete and a kind of architectural placelessness. If you zoom out, as you can see in the satellite view, this purple line is the line of the river. And you can see the river and the surrounding area. Up here is the watershed at the top of the San Jose Mountains, Santa Cruz Mountains. And near here is the old Almaden, which during the gold rush days was primarily a mercury mine, and whose mercury-filled waste washed into the Guadalupe River and is still very present today. If you zoom out further, you can see a long view of the bay. Here's the bay. Here's the river, little river still, as it connects to the Pacific. And you can see, like I said, the watershed, the river, the South Bay. San Francisco's up here. And last zoom out, if you zoom out again, you can see how the runoff from the Guadalupe River continues into the South Bay and contributes to the Pacific Ocean, where the current joins other currents in what's known as the North Pacific Gyre, but is more colloquially known as the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. The North Pacific Gyre is composed of marine and land litter, and in 2008 was estimated to be twice the size of Texas. It's characterized by exceptionally high concentrations of suspended plastic and other debris that have been trapped by the currents, and in essence forms an ever-growing whirlpool of trash. On the left, you can see the Los Angeles River after high water levels have subsided. A lot of that's washing out into the Pacific, obviously. And in the center is a human diver in the gyre. And on the right is a marine bird that washed up in Hawaii, whose decayed remains reveal that its meals were made of plastic. So all of this, obviously, is the makings of a disaster movie, an overwhelming network of interrelations. They didn't want the piece to be heavy-handed, yet I did want to address issues that were very local but connected to the global. So I ended up making a piece that looked realistic, uniting the imagery from the river to the convention center. You can see on the left of one of these kind of closed-circuit monitor systems, a actual closed-circuit camera. And these are everywhere inside the convention center. And although I didn't use them in any way in constructing the piece, they worked so well to the piece's advantage to create a convincing liveness. So I'll show you a little bit of footage. on the project and some in situ kind of context for it. By the way, the title of the piece, Paradoxical Sleep, is a synonym for REM sleep, which is the recurring state of sleep during which you dream. So this is the parking structure that just went by. And what you're looking at is I basically made video of the screens, then I composited and hybridized the river, the convention center, rains, and put those inside the screen. So you were looking sort of in an endless telescope of the convention center reiterated and reiterated inside of itself. And what was amazing was how many people asked me if this was a live transmission. It's just the force of closed circuit is just fantastic for believability. So you can see here's the river, and there was a telephone from inside the convention center in there. Or here, the river is very clearly inside the convention center. The other thing was the maintenance men loved this piece, like that mold coming out of the vents, because they hate this building so much that they just felt like finally, in some metaphoric way, it was coming to its end. So I had great stakeholders, in essence. This is what I'm doing at Marion Spohr, which Kevin had mentioned in New York, is a version of this in an industry city, which is a falling down industrial complex in Brooklyn. There's a very different meaning there and very different feeling, though. Okay, so, please work. This is a work in progress. I wanted to end with this. And I'm gonna just let it run for the rest of the time that we have this evening. I recently found this poem written by Jack Collum. Nature's too slow. People get bored. This piece is called Mesocosm, and this particular one, it's a series, is called Mesocosm, Northumberland, United Kingdom, is a work in progress, an animated landscape representing 1 year of real time on the moors of Northumberland in Northern England. In a 144-hour cycle, animated objects are placed on a stage, and code determines the frequency and order of their appearance. No cycle is identical to the last, as the appearance of characters and seasonal weather are determined by a simple probability equation. 1 hour of world time elapses in each minute of screen time. Seasons unfold, snows fall, days pass, moons rise, animals come and go, and the man in the garden, who's both corporeal and a magical source of food, offers his body to nourish the garden feeders. Real, mythical, and man-made elements interact as they cross the stage of this English landscape in an expanded view of what constitutes nature. This mesocosm in Northumberland was conceived during a 2009 research residency at Isis Arts in Newcastle. It's meant to be seen in public by passers-by, where one might become invested in the fate of the protagonist on a summer's eve, and be surprised 72 hours later when it's snowing and the animated field is full of refugees. And right now, as you're watching, it's close to dawn on June 1st of some unnamed year, and in 24 minutes or so, it will be the same hour, only June 2nd, and so on. So thus the 144-hour cycle. The piece continues to the rest of the seasons, and when 365 days have passed, it'll be June 1st again, and the cycle will continue, although the specific on-screen interactions will probably not repeat. The title Mesocosm is drawn from the field of environmental science and refers to experimental, simulated ecosystems that, quote, allow for manipulation of the physical environment for organismal, community, and ecological research. Mesocosm Northumberland is the first in a series, which will include an array of landscapes that use different data strategies to determine their unfolding. The landscapes include Tsukiji, the largest fish market in the world, in Tokyo, a depleted oil field in Texas, a horse race track, and a farm that grows animals for pharmacological purposes. These landscapes reflect common global concerns while being geographically distinct and culturally specific. Each site evinces a particular and heavy dependency on resources, is an extreme example of managed nature, possesses a rich cultural or mythological history, and embodies a tension between the magically real and the pathologically monetized. Seen together, the landscapes advance a porous and an ambient understanding of the relationship between nature and culture. That relationship is variously enacted as dynamic and by chance, through constant shifts between foreground and background, between who is subject and who is object, between cause and effect. The landscapes are intended to be a form of ambient art. They don't tell stories, but rather allow narrative to emerge from the tensions in networked relations that are both empirical and psychological. I'm looking to use these algorithms and data in these projects, in this kind of a cinematic system, in order to evoke the messy complexity of our natural world and the competing ways in which we mediate it. Mesocosm's landscapes propose that the term nature account for humans' interventions, projections, and superimpositions. I'd characterize this expanded definition of nature with the inclusion of genetically modified, opportunistic, and invasive species, new migratory behaviors of animals in flux from climate change, the post-industrial landscape and its weedy colonies. These landscapes are shared by humans, animals, machines, and fantastic species, from monsters and fairies to transhumanists and furries. This open redefinition of nature offers a structural framework in which to methodically and hopefully playfully tie diverse locales and populations to their inevitable connections with others. So thank you all very, very much for your listening and your eyes and your time. Thank you.
What do you think that your work will look like in 10 years or 15 years?
You mean where will it go visually or
conceptually?
Yes, visually. Well, you know, that's a great question because I have several critiques of what I've done. One is, it upsets me that I present work that sucks so much electricity out of the walls, for one. And I'm very aware of the kind of, tension, let's say, in that. And I also am making more, I didn't talk about any of my performance-based work. I do produce events, let's say. I mean, I'm not in them, but I produce things that happen in real space. And I'm becoming really interested, especially with this Mesocosm series, to produce local events. Like, for instance, I'm doing an invasive species food project that is now out on the table both in Minnesota and in Northumberland to serve, you know, invasive species, the connections, the way that people describe invasive species is not dissimilar from racism. And there's a kind of hatred and xenophobia to the point where food that is eaten in another country won't be eaten locally if it's an invasive species. So in Northern England, it's been a heated debate. And what happens is that people edit out their own kind of complicity in many instances as to why there are invasive species. Either it's because you have globalized commerce, you know, you have hitchhikers, you bring them in as fanciful pets or ornamentals, and then they escape and they do really, really well, and they kind of take over other niches. So, for instance, nobody necessarily in Northern England wants to eat gray squirrel samosas, but I'm proposed a pushcart that's actually manned by or womaned by a person of, you know, non-native person who is very well versed in these issues and very well versed in biology. So it's kind of a foil double foil system where you're given free food. It'll be delicious, but it'll be really uncomfortable to eat it and to engage. So I'm thinking that the work's going to go a little bit more into that real world, and then I don't want to give up my kind of weird solitude of making animation, so I'm sure I'll continue with this. But this piece looks pretty different from the other things, and I'm trying to sort of restrict a lot of my visual languages right now, sort of pull back from all the candy color and get into more sort of fine filigree drawing for whatever perverse reasons. So. Yes.
I'm so inspired by your presentation, and I'm so grateful as an artist for you sharing your process with us.
Thank you.
Which again, completely frames this work in a different way. I wonder, you alluded to some projects that are outside of this type of work. I wonder if you could speak a little bit about collaboration and how and if it plays a role in any of your works. You mentioned that a lot of your work is by yourself, but I know there's other projects that involve other conversations. So I wonder if you could speak a little bit about that.
Well, Yuna and I have an ongoing image text project that we're developing called Zoopolis. It's very open-ended. I think it's going sort of stage by stage. We're looking at this. There's a text by Jennifer Walsh from, I think, 96. It's a very theoretical text about what would happen if you re-envisioned the city as a place that was really of shared animality. And it's very conveniently formal and abstract. So we're sort of trying to figure out what does that look like? What does that really look like? And sort of use that as a lens to look at the city differently. So that's one kind of collaboration between a theorist and a maker, basically, looking. And then these projects that I've done, these performance projects, I did one called Karaoke Ice, which is probably the nicest project I've made. I don't traffic in nice all that often. But it was for the first 01 Biennial in San Jose, and basically I built a truck with a game designer and a graphic designer. And it was you can see it on my website. There's a really nice piece of documentation of it. It was a karaoke truck. The back doors, it was an old Mercury News truck, and the back doors open, and there was a disco ball, and we had kind of, everything was ultra customized. And the truck was manned by the first rodent ethnomusicologist, who was a kind of a 3D avatar escaped from the virtual world. And he was sort of the silent interface or host for the truck, and he'd give you free ice pops, fill you with sugar, and then make you sing. And so the premise of the project was, how do you unite all of these disparate communities that are not normally pedestrian in a place like San Jose? There was a conference in town, this festival. Then you have a bunch of disparate immigrant communities who like karaoke, Filipino, Mexican. And so we did manage. This project was like a grant heaven. We had people from all different areas who were really happy to get in the back of the truck and perform. And the truck sort of tooled around this area for a week. And the idea was that the truck was a woman named Lucci, who in her late 60s, she had been a journalist and realized that to turn herself into a truck and collect music was a way of sort of being in the world in a new way. So she's super colorful and fanciful. It's a crazy project. But that was a great collaboration. It took a year to make it. Everything we customized, it wasn't a karaoke machine. We made all of the music was by the same composer who did Slurve. He basically made these kind of Fabergé eggs of 21 pop songs rendered as ice cream truck music. Does anybody know ice cream truck? You know the horrible ice cream truck music comes out of a little organ player? But these were like incredible pop songs. So it was, now I look back fondly, I sort of cringed at how kind of sweet it was for a while, but it was a nice project.
Thank you for your presentation. I had a question. In the beginning, you had a quotation that we are all one world, right? Humans and animals. In the very beginning.
I'm going to pull it up for you.
Yeah, okay. Unfortunately, it was saying something like, unfortunately, we're all one world. And my question would be, if it's true, how do humans reach this harmony with animals, with nature? Yeah, we are the world, unfortunately. So what should we do as humans to reach this harmony with nature and with animals? What is our purpose as species?
I'm going to answer your question in the back now. What do I hope you get out of my work? It would be to generate this kind of discourse, actually, to have more of this kind of discussion, something that people are really interested in talking about. You know, I'm not prescriptive. I don't have a ton of prescriptive solutions for how to do that. I mean, one really important thing is to be present in the world with your environment and to listen and look at what's right in front of you in terms of just these sort of, there are these amazing tiny moments of interaction we already have. And another thing is I feel like I'm in the minority in this, but your individual actions, like not taking a bag or not buying lots, like not taking that many plastic, but getting a water bottle, actually develop consciousness that makes you put pressure on big business. Ultimately, it's big business that's going to make changes. But in the meantime, Yuna used the word intimacy. There's a kind of an intimacy that I think we need to have with the rest of the world that isn't all mediated, which is, again, you know, what you were saying, where do I see my work going? My critique is that it's very distanced and that we need more kind of real interaction in the world as well as to address the world of mediated material. They're both really important. Issues of representation are really important, and issues of kind of hands-on, present, listening and looking and smelling are really important.
In many of your pieces, you had a combination of issues that seemed very disconnected. Like you had the ice caps melting and the technological waste and the children with guns. How is it that you go about selecting the issues that you're going to combine?
Yeah, because it is weird. It's not exactly socially cogent, right? But each of them is quite different. I mean, that piece in particular is a very strange combination of things. And I had responded emotionally to three really big issues that happened within the space of a few months of each other. This e-waste tipping, the rise of the polar bear, both from Knut and Al Gore, and the Virginia Tech shooting all happened within this really small, like the first quarter of the year, the first, you know, less than half of the year. And they just, sometimes you just see it. Sometimes I think you see it. And that's a very visual piece, obviously. And that was a piece I don't even remember having a moment of hesitation about tossing somebody out or some camp of ideas out. That piece just made itself. It was a very, very rare thing. And I know it's a really strange landscape. But there was something about the innocence of those little pink children and these polar bears and the ambiguity between them. And this kind of Eden, you don't know if they're adversarial or they're in collusion with each other. It's a really ambivalent relationship that the very isolated characters in that piece have. And both of them are top of the food chain animals, both humans and polar bears. They don't have predators above them. So they kind of worked as a symmetry as well. And then the e-waste just, I am a sort of formalist in a way, you know, or a visual. I'm seduced by the visual. I think that e-waste is kind of magnificent looking.